At the end of the last video, you were asked to try these practice problems. At this time, please pause the video and attempt these problems. Make sure that you have your polyatomic ion sheet handy to assist in answering these questions. Please check your answers. Remember that all the normal rules still apply, so your transition metals still require Roman numerals, and your other elements, if necessary, still change accordingly. Also remember that whenever you have more than one of a polyatomic ion, you have to put it in parentheses. For example, if we go through and we do the ammonium one, we know that NH4 is plus 1. We know that S is minus 2. Remember to cross the charges, not the subscripts. So these cross. And if we wrote it like this, it makes it look like there are 42 H's. So we don't want to do that. We instead put it in parentheses and put the 2 on the outside. Even polyatomic ions like OH require the parentheses when there's more than one, because if you wrote it like this, it again makes it appear that you have one calcium, one oxygen, and two H's, where in reality you have two OH groups. So it's really important every time you have more than one polyatomic that you put it in parentheses. And again, this takes practice. There's practice available online. We're now going to kind of transition. So we spent a lot of time talking about ionics. Now we're going to talk about things that are covalent. Personally, I think these are a little bit easier than the ionics, because for the ionic compounds, you have to know all your charges, figure out the subscripts, you have to know all those polyatomics, you have to know your Roman numerals. Covalent compounds, their name tells you exactly how many because of prefixes. Now you are going to have to memorize these prefixes. However, once they're in your head, you're good to go. So, one is mono, two is di, three is tri, four is tetra, five is penta, six is hexa, seven hepta, 8 octa, 9 nana, and 10 deca. Most of these are geometric shapes, so they shouldn't be too hard to remember. When we name things that are covalent, the name is always two words. The first element we always leave the same as before, so you take the name right off the periodic table. The second element you change the ending to IDE, always. These always end in IDE. And you would put the prefix, if there needs to be one, the name of the element. You put the prefix. You put the second element name. You just make sure you change its ending to IDE. For example, carbon dioxide, because there are two O's and one carbon. We never write mono on the first element in the formula. And we try our very best to avoid double vowels. For example, the CO would be carbon. And we know since there's a single O, it's mono. We don't write it like this, carbon monoxide, or I'm actually not even sure how you would say that. So instead, we put one O, and it's just carbon monoxide. You are not crossing your charges on these at all. You're just looking at the given prefix and the element that it's attached to, and you are keeping it there. So let's do a few of these problems. N2O. It's telling you there's two nitrogens. The prefix for two is di. So this is going to be dinitrogen. Then there's one oxygen, so it's going to be the prefix mono, but we don't double vowel it. So it's dinitrogen monoxide. Let's jump down here. You're not crossing your charges. The di is on the phosphorus, so you're going to keep the 2 with the P. And the pent is on the oxide, so you're going to keep the 5 on the O. Please pause the video and attempt the rest of these problems. Please check your answers. One of the most common mistakes I see is hydrogen is hydride, not hydroxide. And then if you did misspell, so you put like the hepta oxide, not the end of the world. But for the most part, these aren't usually too bad. And then again, no crossing of charges. So the tetra is on the iodine, that's why it's I4, and the non, which is 9, is on the oxygen. Right. On the test, you are going to have to be able to determine if something is ionic or covalent first, and then properly name or write its formula. Let's kind of transition now to the remainder of the chapter, which gets a little bit away from naming and formula writing. Let's focus on our electrons again. It's been a little while. So which electrons are always involved in bonding? It's the ones on the outside. So it's your outer shell electrons or your valence electrons. Okay. We reviewed this, or we talked about this in a previous unit. Valence electrons are your outer electrons. They are equal to the group number that they're in. So for example, Br is in 7a, so it has 7 valence electrons. Your core electrons are all the other ones. They don't play a role in bonding, so we really don't care about them at this point. We have something called the octet rule. The octet rule says that every atom wants a full valence shell, which is usually 8 valence electrons. They can get these electrons by gaining, losing, or sharing them. Our main focus in this part of the chapter is on the sharing of electrons. Our noble gases are unreactive because our noble gases are 8A. So they already have 8 valence electrons. Since they already have a full shell, they don't want any more, so they don't participate in bonding. Let's kind of come back to these Lewis dot diagrams. We briefly mentioned them earlier on in the chapter. A Lewis dot diagram is a way of keeping track of your valence electrons. They can be helpful in us determining what ion would exist. They're going to be helpful in identifying the shape of something, and they can be really helpful in determining the number of bonds that something can make. When you draw a Lewis dot structure, you always write the chemical symbol first, and then you're going to use dots to represent electrons. So this X here is any chemical symbol on the periodic table. And then it doesn't matter where you start with your dots. You just have to make sure that you spread them out first before you pair them. So if you put your first dot here, your second would go here, your third would go here, your fourth would go here. Now that there's one top side, bottom side, you can pair them. So your fifth would go here, your sixth would go here, your seventh, and your eighth. Let's do a couple of examples because I think that general formula can be a little confusing. So nitrogen is in group 5A, so it's going to get 5 valence electrons. I draw its symbol, and then I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Br is in group 7a, so it has 7 valence electrons. So I write its symbol, and then I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. At this time, please pause the video and attempt these practice problems. As you can see here, I have the answers. Sodium has 1 valence electron, so it gets 1 dot. Magnesium has 2, so it gets 2, so on and so forth. Helium is unique, and you'll see that I put a star next to it. Helium is in group 8A, but it only has a total of 2 valence electrons, so it's only allowed to have a total of 2 dots. Because it is a noble gas and does not participate in bonding, these 2 dots are put together. It's one of the only exceptions to the rule. Okay, hopefully that wasn't too bad. Now instead of atoms, we're going to talk about molecules. For covalent bonds, electrons are shared. In general, most elements want full valence shells. And covalent molecules can form multiple bonds, so some double and triple bonds as well. There are a couple of very important exceptions. In a molecule, when bonds are formed, both H and HE only want a total of 2 dots. Boron is unique in that it only wants a total of 6. And S and P are unique because they can actually have additional dots. So they can end up with 10 to 12 dots instead. They can expand their octets, which we'll talk a little bit more about in future slides. Let's kind of talk about the type of bonds. Single bonds are going to be 2 total electrons, double bonds will be 4, and triple bonds will be 6. If we ranked these in order of length and strength, single bonds would be the longest, double would be in the middle, triple would be the shortest, which should make sense because if there's more electrons, they're going to pull the atoms closer together, making a shorter bond. It's the opposite for strength. Single bonds are the weakest because they're only 2 electrons, double bonds are in the middle, and triple bonds are the strongest because they're 6 electrons. More electrons means stronger. Here are some quick examples of a single bonded substance. Here's a double bonded substance. We'll talk more about these on the next couple of slides. And a triple bonded substance. Let's continue. So let's talk about how to draw these dot structures for molecules. The chemical formula is going to tell you the structure. The central atom is the element that you have the least amount of in the chemical formula. It's usually also the one that's the least electronegative. Okay, so here, carbon is going to be in the center because there's one of them. Nitrogen will be in the center for this one because there's one of them. And Si would go in the center for that one because there's one of them. The number of single dots on anything, but primarily on the central atom, tell you the number of bonds that atom can form. For example, CH4, carbon goes in the middle. It's in group 4A, so it would get 4 dots. That means it can make 4 bonds. And conveniently, there are 4 H's, so they each bring in their dot. And that would be your dot structure. We will continue from here in our next video.